Good morning, everybody. My name is Stephen. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the lead pastor here. Welcome to Redemption City Church. We believe that everyone is invited to experience redemption. And so every week we get together, we open up scripture, and we let God teach us from it. This week we're going to be in 2 Kings chapter 23. If you have a Bible, you can turn it in there and kind of get ready for where we're headed. Over the next 6 weeks, we're going to be in a series called Church Inc., Church Incorporated. And it's going to be a six-week series, and we're going to ask the question that's probably on the screen behind me. What is church supposed to be like? What is church supposed to be like? This last Wednesday, I went on a little road trip down to Marion, and I got picked up at 6:30 in the morning, and I didn't have time to get my shake made, so we stopped and had some breakfast along the way, and we stopped at a fast food restaurant, pretty popular one that you've all heard of, and I had a hash brown because they are delicious, and an egg McMuffin. You can probably guess where I went, and it was pretty good. I had some coffee, and then we went to the correctional facility where we had this visit with this guy, and we did that, and then after that, we journeyed on our way home. It was about 12:30-ish, we rolled into Findlay. We were hungry again, and so we stopped, and we had a couple of options. We could go to that same restaurant. We could go to that restaurant's like eight competitors that were all on the same exit. We decided to go to Culver's, which I'm told is like half fast food, kind of like Chick-fil-A, Chipotle, you know, and whatever else. And so we went to Culver's, and I ordered a salad. So it was a fast food salad, which means it's half salad and half fast food. And I went through it, ate it, also had like a 1,500-calorie ice cream dessert, which negated the salad, and enjoyed it, drove home. And as I was got home and kind of like settling in, I thought, when is the last time I had fast food twice in one day? I couldn't actually remember the last time, not including, of course, Chipotle, Chick-fil-A, and Balance, everything else. And so I was kind of processing through that, particularly as I was thinking about this sermon. See, a couple of years ago, a documentary came out. Some of you may have heard of it. It's called Food, Inc. Food, Inc. Got very popular on Netflix. Messed with everybody who watched it. And the basic premise of Food, Inc. was this: that because of the industry of food, something that was originally intended to be unbelievably healthy and sustaining, like the outside of water, the basic sustenance of life, because industry had stepped in, had corrupted and perverted something that was originally intended to be fantastic. But it had crept in, and now the stuff that we put into our bodies to make us healthy is actually killing us. That's the premise of the documentary. You can believe it or not, I don't really care. That's not the point of my sermon. I don't care what you eat. But that was the point of it. And it got wildly popular to the point where everyone was like, oh, I can't believe you eat there. Have you seen the documentary? All these diets came out as a fad afterwards, like everything, you know, and we're still kind of living that. Like all of a sudden, everybody's gluten-free and vegan and vegetarian and everything else, and that's fine if you choose to do that, totally fine, right? But then one came up more recently, paleo, the paleo diet. Now, I don't know a whole bunch about the paleo diet, but this is what I do know about the paleo diet. You ask yourself the question, what could a caveman eat? And you go back and you think, what did the cavemen have? What could they eat? Before everything was processed, added to, changed, morphed, steroided, whatever else, what did they originally eat? Because as it was originally created, it is probably really healthy. And so you go back to that if you're paleo. We are going on a church paleo diet for 6 weeks. This is not a series. This is a statement. It's not just a fill in the gap before Easter. It's a this is who we are. Church Inc. is asking the question, is it possible that through 2,000 years of culture and tradition, 2,000 years, or not 2,000 years, but then maybe more 200 years of more modern culture and tradition, that the church we have now has been changed from the church as it was originally intended to be. And that in the same way, food is maybe not as healthy as it was back then, though it might taste better because of everything you put into it, it's not actually what it's supposed to be. And it doesn't have the nutrients and the power, I'm just talking about church now, not food, that it was supposed to have. That a church that came out of the Pentecost, Jesus' spirit falling down and things happening like crazy, where you didn't look and think, oh man, the church grew from 100 to 200. That's incredible. The church went from 0 to 3,000. The church in Ephesus was 20,000 people out of 200,000 in the city. It makes a reference that the entire economy of the city was changed by the church. That is it possible that all of that tradition and culture has left us with something that doesn't look anything like what it was supposed to look like? And that in that, it loses its power. In that, it loses all that it was supposed to add. Let's do a little bit of theology real quick. Our ultimate allegiance is to God, our Father, right? Who sent his Son, he saved us. Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit, who now empowers us. Jesus came, and he came to bring a kingdom. Came to bring a kingdom. And his kingdom is wherever his values are lived out. His kingdom is wherever what he taught is lived. That's his kingdom. The ultimate resting place for each and every one of us who are in Christ is in God's full kingdom here on earth. That's news to you. You don't spend eternity in heaven. You spend eternity on the kingdom here on earth. Fully redeemed. Fully redeemed. Kingdom here on earth. Now within his kingdom, he has a plan of redemption. A strategy for advancing his kingdom. And you know what it's called? His church. His church. The kingdom and the church, they're not the same thing. The church is a function of the kingdom. And then within his church, his universal church, and there are multiple metaphors that are used for church throughout the scripture, and we'll hit some of them because understanding all of the metaphors gives us a better picture of what it was really supposed to be like when we look at all the metaphors, not just one or two. The church, his body. Now, if you look at scripture, you see a couple of things that are true of the church right at the beginning. The first one is this. There were multiple expressions of it. He writes to the churches at Corinth, multiple, all in one city. Sometimes it's to the church, sometimes it's to the churches. There were always multiple expressions of the church, and there were always problems. You've probably heard it said, if it's a perfect church, don't go there, you'll blow it. It's true. It's true. There are always problems. There are always multiple expressions, but it was always God's plan. His strategy of redemption was through his church, his body, the arms and the feet and the hands of Jesus, his church. We're going to be in 2 Kings chapter 23 today to get started. And in 2 Kings 23, there's this young king. And when I say young, I mean young. His name's Josiah. He became king at the age of 8. Some of you have an 8-year-old. Imagine them as king. He became king at the age of 8, 18 years into his kingdom, which made him a whopping 24. He decided to restore the temple. And so he sent some of his people into the temple. And he said, this isn't the way it's supposed to be. Let's fix this up a little bit. And as they're doing that, they discover something, a scroll. Scholars agree that it was the book of Deuteronomy. I believe 31 chapters in our Bible. It's kind of long. That's important later. So they discover the book of Deuteronomy and it's presented to King Josiah, this young 24-year-old king. And so the king begins to listen to the book of Deuteronomy read to him and his heart is convicted, cut to the core. And this is his basic idea. Oh, that's not how we do things. He hears scripture read and he's like, whoa, we have gotten so far away from that. Now, he's the king. He's a figurehead. He's over the nation, right? So we're not just talking about a church. We're talking about a nation right here. And this young 24-year-old king, he's cut to the core by scripture. And so then this is what he does. This is starting in 23. He says, then the king, Josiah, 24 years old, and all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem were gathered to him. All of the elders come in and get together. There's something that I think is true, that when God really moves, he moves in unity. When God really moves, he moves in unity. And I can say, this is me, I'm not speaking for anyone else, but for me, as I have sat down and chatted with people, our elders, our staff, even some of you in this church, and have presented just a snapshot of some of the ideas that are going to be coming through this series, it's been amazing to me how heads have just started nodding or sentences have been finished. As I've talked with other pastors, even around this city or things I check into like nationally, listen publicly, all that kind of stuff, it's amazing to me how there is like this sense of people kind of all saying the same thing. Here's why that's really good. We're not on an island. We're not trying to like set some pace that's unlike anything else. I feel like maybe more than any time in my career, this series is just jumping into what God is doing. That our church is just kind of like fitting in with what God wants to do. I think that's really good news. When God moves, he moves in unity. Then the king sent, and all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem were gathered to him. And the king went up to the house of the Lord. And with him, all the men of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem and the priests and the prophets, all the people, both small and great. All of them. I mean, they use the word all there a lot in those couple of verses. He said, we need everybody in on this. Everyone. He said, hey, if we're really going to reform, if we're really going to change, if we're really going to shift as a kingdom. And by the way, at this point in time in the kingdom of Israel, there's already been a sentence placed over them. God has pretty much already said, hey, listen, you're all going into captivity. You guys messed up too much. You're going into captivity. And Josiah then actually, after that sentence has already been levied out, he then hears this and he comes and wants to present reform. And later on in the text, it's like Josiah knows, listen, this might not change what God wants to do. Like he might still punish us, but it's still the right thing to do, so we're going to do it. It's still right. And so he's saying, and we're all going to do this. We're all going to do this. And so he gets everyone. All the people, regardless of race, regardless of economic class, regardless of education, regardless of their significance, importance, or whatever it might be, regardless of their political persuasion, regardless of whatever thing might divide people, he says, all of us come here. All of us come here, and let's listen to this. Gets them all together. Which, by the way, is a reminder to us that you are an essential part of God's church. You are an essential part of God's church. 15 or 55, you are an essential part of God's church. If you are a follower of Christ, you are a part of his church. There's not, you can't be a Christian and say, I'm not a part of the church. You are a part of the church. You may not be a part of a 501c3 tax ID, but you are a part of the church. We all are, if we are in him. And you are essential to the body of Christ. And he read in their hearing, get this, okay? You think church is long. And he read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant. That means he got them all together. He started at Deuteronomy 1:1. And a lot of these guys, because, you know, they're Jewish, good Jewish kids. They grew up and they probably had to memorize the first five books of the Bible because that's what you did in, you know, Jewish elementary school. And by the time he got to chapter 2, probably started looking at each other like, is he going to do the whole thing? He did. All 31 chapters. He just gets up and he just starts reading and reading and reading. And he reads through the entire book of the covenant. Entire book of the covenant. Now, it is significant, by the way, that it is referred to here as the book of the covenant and not the book of the law. Why? Because here's what Josiah is not going to do. Josiah is not going to look at everybody and he's going to say, hey, in this, there's a system of laws and structures and we've got to go back and we got to follow every one of them. And it's not that he's going to say we shouldn't follow what God has instructed us to do. What he's going to do, though, is paint it in a better picture. And he's going to say, we're going to look at the book of the covenant. We're going to look and to restore our relationship with God, not the religious institution that we need to follow. The book of the covenant, there's so much more hope in that than the book of the law, because what do we know about the book of the law? We'll all fail it. We'll never live up to it. Josiah says, be restored. We have to look at this book of the covenant. I've said this about covenant before. It's like the love side of a marriage and the legal side of a contract. Let me add this to it. A covenant says this, I would rather die than depart. That's a covenant. I'd rather die than depart. I'd rather die than depart. That's why we say marriage is a covenant. I'd rather die than depart, right? I'd rather die than depart. God made a covenant. He made one through Abram. He made one through Moses. He made one through David. He made a covenant with his people. He said, I'd rather die than depart. And then he proved it. He did die, so he wouldn't have to depart. He departed from his son on the cross so that he would never have to depart from us. Because he'd rather die than depart. Josiah says, we're going to make a covenant back to you, God. So he gets in front of him and he reads the entire book of the covenant that had been found in the house of the Lord. And the king stood by the pillar. I tried to find why that was in there. I think it's just to make him seem esteemed. The king stood by the pillar. Can you picture this? All the people are out there. They've just read the entire book of Deuteronomy. Josiah is now standing up there in his place as the king. He's looking out at his people. The king stood by the pillar and he made a covenant before the Lord. He said, I'd rather die than depart. And this was his covenant. To walk after the Lord and to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and all his soul, his heart and his soul, all of it. He's looking out at all of them. And he said, I am making a covenant. I'm making it right here with all of you as my witnesses. Right? This is why we have witnesses at a wedding, right? So there's other people that hold us to the covenant. And he's up there and he's saying, I'm making a covenant right now before God that I'm going to walk after him and I'm going to keep everything that he says. And I'm going to believe it and I'm going to commit to it with all of my heart and with all of my soul. With everything that I am, I'm going to adhere to that which we just heard because it's what it was originally intended to be. It's a king getting up and confessing to his entire nation, we've gone astray. We're not doing this the right way. We have got to go back. We've got to go back. Over the next 5 weeks, we're going to ask the question, what is church supposed to be like? And we're going to answer it with scripture, with the Bible. We're going to look at it because it tells us. Now, where it doesn't tell us, we trust the Holy Spirit to fill in these little blanks, but through example and through actual words, the scripture shows us this is what church is. This is what it's supposed to be like. And when it is what it is supposed to be, it is unlike anything else. It is unlike anything else that exists when the church is what it is supposed to be. And so he gets up in front. He says, I'm making this covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord, to keep his commandments and his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart and all his soul. He is in. He's sold out. He's not going anywhere. He says to perform the words of this covenant that were written in the book. That passage right there reminds me of Jesus' half-brother when he's writing, when he says you can't just listen, you can't just hear, you actually have to do the words that are written in. He's saying a similar thing. He's saying, we're not just going to listen to the words of the covenant. We're actually going to perform them. We're going to do it. We're going to live up to our end of the bargain. We're going to change, even if it's slightly uncomfortable. Nation, we're going to move and we're going to go back to what it was supposed to be. That's what we're going to do. Look what happens.
It says all the people joined in the covenant. After he gave his little speech, it's like every hand went up. And they're like, hey, we're in too. We're in too. We realize that maybe we've even played a role in this, Josiah, that it wasn't just you and it wasn't just the elders. It was all of us. It was all of us rebelling and rejecting God's plan. It was all of us doing that and moving in. And here's what I'm asking of each and every one of us. Maybe we've played a part of the problem in making church what it wasn't supposed to be. And can I say this? Chief sinner. Just chief sinner. And at times, making church not what it was supposed to be. Of emphasizing the wrong things, of asking the wrong questions, making the wrong comparisons. I'm grateful for God's forgiveness and his conviction. And maybe we all have to sit down and we have to evaluate again. Am I committed to the covenant? Am I committed to it and to do and to live it as this says we should? Now, I don't know about you, but when I eat like paleo bread, my dad calls it fake bread, right? It's not as good as the real stuff. It isn't. I mean, let's just be honest. It's not. But I would imagine that if you stick to it after a while, it actually starts to taste good. Like anything that you've given up, I mean, how many people have you talked to who gave up pop, and now when they take a sip, they're like, ugh. That eventually, when you kind of begin to set it aside for a while, your body begins to reset itself, craving that which it was originally intended to crave. Is it possible that although it might not taste as good at first, although it might be a little bit difficult, that if we worked through this, if we stuck to it, if we were focused enough, if we were committed to the covenant, that eventually we might find ourselves in a place where our hearts and our souls are craving what the church originally intended to offer? Is it even more possible that a city, lost people, that what they're not turned off by is Jesus, but the church? Jesus. Not Jesus, but religion. I met Cody on Friday afternoon. And we're walking through this, we're just having this conversation, you know, I met him at a place where we were both hanging out, and we're talking, and finally it comes up, and he asked me a question, what do you do, right? And so I got to it, I told him what I do, and he said, no blankety blank, and then he said, man, I'm a believer. I said, great, let's talk. So we started talking, we're going through this whole thing, and man, like your kids would have to cover their ears for half of this conversation. And we're sitting there and we're just having this conversation, and I'm asking him, and at some point he goes, man, I don't always do this, but and he starts pulling up his shirt and he's tatted from here to here, and he starts pointing out all of the different things, and it's the story of his life, right? And it's beautiful, by the way. I mean, it was beautiful. The tattoo was beautiful. The story was even more beautiful. And I just started working through it. I said, so tell me what happened. He walked through his story, walked through it all and everything like that. And I could see the hurt. I could see the pain. I could see where he was blaming the church. I could see where it was his fault too. I mean, I could see it all. I asked him, I said, what are the chances of you ever walking into church again? He said, about 1 in 1,000. I said, well, if you do, I hope it's ours. We'd love to have you. I gave him a card. I said, show up whenever you want. Everyone's invited to experience redemption. Everyone. I wonder how many Codys there are out there sometimes. I really do. How many Codys are out there? They're never going to walk in to the building. Cody's a believer. He's a believer. I have no doubt. He is. He's a believer. And he's never going to walk in. I wonder how many others out there who aren't even believers that would never walk in. And here's the deal. Here's why I'm telling you this story. It's not to make us feel bad. It's because I want us to be honest. I want us to be honest as we journey through this series. To be honest about what it is that we're creating here. To be honest about, in the early stages of this church, where are we pointed? What direction are we headed? If we kept on the same path that we're at right now, would Cody come to our church in a year? If we just did what we've always done, if we inputted the same things to get the same outputs, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, who are we? But maybe we're young enough, small enough, flexible enough to look and say, God, before we get too far into this, tell us who you want us to be. Tell us who you want us to be. Over the next 4 weeks, I'm going to dive into 4 points. So I'm going to give them to you as kind of a wrap-up. They may be on the screen behind me, but I might change the words up a little bit, so just forgive me. The first one is this. Church is not a product we consume. It's an experience with God's presence. Can I say that again? Church is not a product that we consume. It is an experience with God's presence. And I say chief sinner again because I know how to make good church. I know how to put out a good product. And I say chief sinner because when I walk out of that door on Sunday and the first thought is, did the band hit their transitions? That's product. That's just all it is. It's church ink. How's our brand? How's our logo? It's church ink. Second one. Church is a family, not a social club. Social clubs are homogenous groups that get together around a common thing. They like to golf. They play tennis. Bridge. People still play bridge? I don't know. Yoga. Whatever it might be. Church is not a social club. It's a family. It's a family. And that might even be uncomfortable for some. Why? Because we've grown up in social club church. In the same way the paleo bread tastes kind of bad. That idea of, oh, I have to know people then. Because that's how we've been trained. Church is a family, not a social club. There was a guy in our church who went to the hospital a couple months ago, weeks ago maybe, and I and the elders showed up, and we just showed up to pray with him and all of that kind of stuff, and he had some incredible words. And I can say this, I think, about this couple. Had we not shown up to the hospital, they wouldn't have left. Had we shown up to the hospital, they wouldn't have given us any less money than they give us. Had we not shown up to the hospital, I don't think they really would have blamed us. I don't think they would have been that upset. Which means we could have not gone. And the incorporated part of our church would function the same way. But church is a family. Not a club. Church is a family, not a building or an organization. Well, let's play a game. Tell me about your family. And this is how you respond. Well, we live in Perrysburg. There's this nice neighborhood. We have a black top driveway. There's a basketball hoop. Then you walk in. There's this nice red door. It is such a nice door. Then you open the door, and to the left is a very spacious living room with child-appropriate furniture. And then after that, you move into the dining room. We rarely eat in the dining room, only when grandma comes over. And then after you move in that, you go into the kitchen. We got brand new granite. Oh, it's so nice. And the all of our, the fridge and everything else, it's brand new, stainless steel. Oh yeah. And then you go upstairs. There's 4 bedrooms, 3 bathrooms. It's incredible. And I'm sitting there on the other end. I was like, I asked you about your family. And that's how you described it. Then why do we do that about our churches? Tell me about your church. Oh, we meet at blank and blank. Tell me about your church. Oh, we meet blank, blank and blank. Tell me about your church. Oh, it's built like this. Oh, the auditorium, there's a great kids' space. If we would never describe our families by our home, why do we do our churches by our buildings? We've bought into something. It's potentially Satan's best lie. That if he could cripple God's weapon, his church, that he could control things he wasn't meant to control for centuries. That if he could get us thinking more about product and club and building than family and presence, he wins. Should your family have a house? Yes. Can it be nice? Yes. Should the church have a building? Sure. Can it be nice? Yes. That's fine. Should we be known by that? No. 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 Last one. Sometimes I like to picture Paul in, like, you know, 60 AD thinking. And he gets this snapshot of 2017, and he sees the church. His first thought is, wow, we own a lot of property. And then his second thought is, there are so many people that get paid to do this. Look at every coffee shop in the city. It's amazing. And I wonder if for a second he would have thought, okay, if this is how many people get paid to do this, I can't imagine the people who don't get paid, the saints, who according to Ephesians chapter 4 are to carry out the work of ministry, how much must they get done if we can have all of these people who get paid to do this? And then I think what may happen is Paul might start looking into it more and more. And he might think, oh no, the expectation is just, let the paid people do everything. This is not a slam on the congregation. This is a slam on, right? Ephesians 4 is really clear. Really clear. The saints, the church is equipped to do the work of ministry. That was how it was supposed to be. This like hierarchical, like paid professional structure thing, it's not in here. Yes, Paul does say, listen, a worker is worth his wages. Okay? Like if your whole life is about the gospel, then you should get paid by that, right? Okay, so there is some room for this. And we can trust the Holy Spirit to teach us this. I started chatting with people. I said, what if we got to a place as a church? And I'm just throwing out ideas. I said, what if we got to a place as a church where we operated on 20% and gave away 80%? What if we could get there? What if we were so committed to looking at this, to being in a building that wasn't going to cost us 70% of everything that comes in? To execute ministry in a way where we didn't have to hire somebody every 20 people that come in. To do it in such a way where we looked that at any money that came in, not as a way to build a brand or an organization, but as a way to unleash God's power and his presence and to take care of those who need it. So what if we started that now? Like what if that was the picture of what we were moving to? Because where you set your aim, for most of us, we'll get there. Right? So let's adjust our aim. Let's adjust our aim. To be a family, not a club, a brand, a building, or an organization. To be about his presence, not the product. Because I'll tell you what, some of us, we've experienced church at its worst. I mean, whenever it was in your life, I mean, you've just kind of experienced it, maybe. You know, and I will kind of just paint a little bit of a picture. I mean, church at its worst, it can be full of gossip and slander because we can be that. It can be more about performance than presence. It can elevate the organization over the individual. It can be more about growing a brand than the kingdom. It can be void of Holy Spirit power, but a lot of feel good. It can lead to division, dissension, despair. And we've all probably experienced church at its worst at times. But I hope you've also experienced church at its best, at its absolute best. Because when church is at its best, Jesus uses it to redeem things. Lives, relationships, a city, like he did in Ephesus. When church is at its best, I think there's a power to it. When church is at its best, people who need healed are healed. We had a gathering on Friday night because we went and served at Mosaic. At Vision. And we were down there and we're serving there. And as we're serving, we had like 40 volunteers and we fed meals to like 50 people. And then we invited everyone to go out to eat afterwards. And so we went out to eat afterwards. And as I was driving home with Lindsay afterwards, I said, that was a great day of church. That was a great day of church. No one preached. We didn't sing any songs. We served and we hung out. And there was this thought that came in the back of my mind that it's almost like I felt like if somebody would have been sick right then and there, I just think that there would have been almost greater power of us rallying around right there and praying over that person in the middle of that Mexican restaurant than maybe what we experience in our building sometimes. Because when church is at its best, and we'll look at this, we'll look at church at its best. The lost are found. The city is served. The presence of God shows up in power. Jesus is in charge of it. There's unity amongst the people. The kingdom advances, and a family on mission is formed when church is at its best. And I think we have a choice, guys. Reform or repeat. Reform or repeat. Like when Josiah stood out in front of all the people and he said, hey guys, we can reform like the book says, or we can repeat what we've always done. I think we can do that too. We can reform or repeat. So I'll make a covenant before you guys. My heart and my soul, I'm in this thing. I am in this thing to see what God wants to do. And don't get me wrong, my ultimate allegiance is to him. And to his kingdom, and to his universal church. But then my heart and my soul is right here with each of you and wherever God wants to bring us and whatever he wants to do in us. And I hope you'll do the same over these next 5 weeks, that we will together commit to the covenant to see the church as much as we can in our imperfection become what it's supposed to be.